Good evening, everybody. Bonsoir. On va commencer dans quelques minutes. We're going to start in just a couple of minutes. Just have a few announcements to make. There are two emergency exits from this room, one on each side, the right and the left, the main doors that you entered, and another over on this side. And if you need to find the washrooms, please just go out the main exit and to your right. Donc, il y a deux sorties d'urgence dans la salle, l'entrée principale et une autre de ce côté-ci. Pour les toilettes, vous sortez par l'entrée principale et vous allez à la droite. On va commencer dans quelques minutes. We'll be ready in just a few minutes. Merci. Thank you.
Thank you. So if everyone could take a seat, we'll get started. Great. So good evening, bonsoir. My name is Christy Spence. I'm the director of the Quebec Urban Lands and Gatineau Park at the National Capital Commission. Welcome to tonight's Urbanism Lab at the NCC and our special session tonight highlighting all the great research, or some of the great research that we conduct on NCC lands. Donc, bienvenue. Welcome as well to everyone who might be watching on tonight's live stream via YouTube. The capital is blessed with a rich natural heritage, vast expanses of green space, and diverse ecosystems. Des trésors naturels comme l'escarpement d'Eudley au Parc de Gatineau, la mer bleue dans la ceinture de verdure et le lac Mott dans la capitale urbaine, nos magnifiques berges et nos beaux secteurs riverains sont essentiels au caractère et à l'identité unique de la capitale, ainsi qu'à la capitale de vie dont nous jouissons ici. As the chief planner and steward of the capital, protecting and preserving this heritage is a significant part of the NCC's mandate. Our own staff, some of whom are here tonight, is talented and dedicated to this mandate, and here in the capital, we're really fortunate to be able to leverage our in-house capacity by partnering and collaborating with many other scientists and researchers from government, universities, agencies, museums, NGOs, and colleges here and across the country. And actually this afternoon we did have a number more of our collaborators presenting this afternoon. In my role, I can tell you just how valuable these partnerships are because I see the results firsthand every day. As an example, last year in partnership with the Université de Québec en Outaouais and the David Suzuki Foundation, we carried out the first study to assess the value of the natural capital of the NCC's green spaces, and some of you may have been present at that Urbanism Lab. That value is considerable, and the research being done with our partners helps us every day to ensure that we maintain and enhance it. Their work informs the evidence-based planning and policy making that will see the natural legacy that we've inherited passed on for generations to come. Tonight, we're very happy to welcome three researchers who are here to discuss their exciting work that they're doing on NCC lands. Our first speaker tonight is Dr. Chris McQuarrie. He's a research scientist with Natural Resources Canada's Canadian Forest Service. Originally from Saskatchewan, Dr. McQuarrie received his doctorate from the University of Alberta in 2008. He works out of the Great Lakes Forestry Centre in Sault Ste. Marie, but an important part of the research that he's conducting with his colleague, Dr. Krista Ryle, the risks imposed by the emerald ash borer and how to contain it, is being carried out here in the capital's forests. Notre deuxième présentateur, Yann Surget-Groba, est un professeur au département des sciences naturelles de l'Université du Québec en Outaouais. Il est aussi un chercheur de l'Institut des sciences de la forêt tempérée. Il a obtenu son doctorat en biologie à l'Université de Rennes, en France. Ce soir, il nous parlerait de son travail qui consiste à utiliser des fragments d'ADN prélevés dans l'eau pour surveiller la biodiversité de nos écosystèmes aquatiques. And finally, but not the least, Margaret Kalachka is an associate professor in the Department of Geography at McGill University. She earned her MSc and her PhD with a specialization in remote sensing from the Earth and Atmospheric Sciences Department at the University of Alberta. Tonight, she will explain how she uses satellite and airborne imaging to observe changes in land use, particularly at the Marabou Bog, and what it means. So thank you all for sharing your expertise with us tonight. Merci de nous avoir rejoints ici dans le labo d'urbanisme. And please hold your questions just till the end of each presentation. You'll have a chance as each speaker finishes. And we'll get started with Dr. McQuarrie. Thank you.
Well, thank you all for coming out on such a damp evening to hear us talk about science. That's me. This is the insect I'll be talking about this evening. It's the emerald ash borer, or Agrylis planipennis. And throughout the presentation, I'll refer to it by its common name, which is the emerald ash borer, but I might occasionally call it EAB, which is just how we know it, because we like our three-letter acronyms. And I'm going to talk about how it came to be in North America, the damage it causes, how the insect is managed, and then I'll close by talking about the biological control work that NRCan has been doing over the past few years, including the work that's been done here on NCC lands. So talk a little bit about the introduction and spread of the insect first. So the Emerald Ash Borer was found in Detroit, Michigan and Windsor, Ontario in 2002, and the first detection was by an arborist who found declining ash trees along a street in Detroit. And this was reported to the Ontario Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry and the Canadian Food Inspection Agency and NRCan, who soon located similar damage on trees in Windsor. The native range of the insect is in China, which has been confirmed by genetic studies. And in Asia, the beetle is not recorded as a pest, except of North American ash trees that have been planted there. So, and in the native variant, the emerald ash borer attacks just weak or dead or dying trees, so it's not a pest of healthy trees. And most of the Asian ash species are resistant to emerald ash borer. It was likely introduced into North America sometime in the 1990s, and this has been confirmed by looking at tree rings from areas where we know emerald ash borer has been. So it was found in 2002, but it was probably there for a lot longer before it was actually detected. So this is the region where emerald ash borer was first detected. And I'm told you can see the green dot on the screen. No? Yes. Okay, not really. Okay. So Detroit is in the center of the map. Everyone knows Detroit. Detroit, Windsor. And I'll just show you a couple maps of how the AAB is spread over time. So this was the known range in 2003, so 1 year after the AAB was detected. And the red and yellow blobs are colored based on the density of infested trees within the area. So 1 year after detection in Detroit, it was already found well outside the metro area and even out into parts of central and northern Michigan. So it was by the time it had been detected, it had already spread quite a ways. And the spread between 2002 and now has been quite rapid. This is an editorial cartoon from a paper in Wisconsin. And the spread is a combination of two factors. And the movement of infested firewood, which we illustrate here, is the EEB hanging out with the camper who's moving firewood from place to place, which you shouldn't do. So it's that movement of firewood from place to place by campers and RVers. And then there's a long lag time between when the insect is introduced into an area and when it's actually detected. And because of that lag, the insect is allowed, can build up populations to the point where it starts to kill trees. And that long gap occurs because the signs and symptoms of infestation only become apparent about 2 or 3 years after it's become established. So they're likely there for a lot longer before they're detected. And what that means is the population of the insect can grow and spread for a long time before anybody can actually start to do anything about it. So we see this where we looked at the map range of the infestation in 2006, or 4 years after detection, and by this time it had already spread up into northern Michigan. So right at the tip of northern Michigan is Sault Ste. Marie, where I'm from. They had it probably there in 2006, and it's been in Sault Ste. Marie since probably about that time, so in northern Ontario for quite a while. And this is the range as of September this year. So any state that's highlighted has emerald ash borer in it, and then it's also found in Ontario and Quebec, as far west as Thunder Bay, and then up this year. I'll get to that in a second. But this is just a blow-up map of Ontario. This is a map from the Ontario Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry. And yellow is anything where we knew emerald ash borer was to be, and pink is the new detections from last year. So as you can see, it's sort of all throughout southeastern Ontario. And we also know it's on Manitoulin Island, and like I said, it's in Sault Ste. Marie and outside Sault Ste. Marie. And in the past 2 years, we picked up what we call two satellite populations. The first one was detected in Thunder Bay in the summer of 2016. And then this summer, it was found in Quebec City on the Plains of Abraham in the city and the neighborhood around that site. And in October, it was reported in Sherbrooke, Quebec in the eastern townships. So the overall impact of emerald ash borer has been estimated in the billions of dollars in both Canada and the United States. And these costs include the treatment or removal of dead and dying trees, and also the associated loss in property values from people who have to take down this big, beautiful tree they have in front of their house, and that the reduction in property values that causes. And the researchers have also documented impacts on human health, where trees have been killed by EB, and the loss of that green canopy is associated with an increase in sort of mortality and morbidity in humans. Basically, people do better when they have trees around them. And so when you have this loss of canopy, you have sort of people don't do quite as well. This is just an illustration from the CBC of this is the article the CBC runs when emerald ash borer is found in a new place. They just sort of recycle the image and change the location. So you'll see this picture again. So just talk a little bit about the biology of the insect. So this is the life cycle. So the adults emerge about the 11 o'clock position. The adults emerge in the spring. They lay these small eggs underneath the bark of ash trees. These eggs hatch, and what comes out are what we call neonate larvae, very small little larvae that burrow into the bark of the tree, begin to feed on the phloem later or the sapwood. They feed there, forming these sort of S-shaped galleries, and that's what actually girdles the tree, and that's what kills the tree. It cuts off the circulation system of the tree. And feeds like that over the summer, and then in the winter it goes into these pupal galleries and forms a sort of J-shaped, and that's how it spends the winter. So if you went and dug underneath the tree in Ottawa that has emerald ash borer right now, you'd probably find them in this stage, just sort of J-shaped stage. It spends the winter like that, and in the spring it pupates. In most of the U.S., it takes 1 year for the insect to go through this cycle. So it emerges as an adult in the spring and pupates, and then the offspring of that one come out the next year. What we're finding in parts of Canada is that it actually takes, most of the population takes 2 years to go around that cycle, just because our climate is colder, they don't develop it quite as fast, and so it actually takes 2 full years for it to go through this cycle, which means populations in parts of Canada actually grow slower than they do in other parts of the U.S., which has implications for how much damage and how fast the populations grow. So we'll talk a bit about the hosts. These are the three most common hosts in Canada: green ash, white ash, and black ash. Green and white ash are common street trees. Black ash is fairly common in the woods. It's fairly common in riparian areas. It's a common street tree in parts of Western Canada. These are not hosts. Manchurian ash is sort of a host, but it's the native host from Asia. So this, but it's resistant to emerald ash borer. This is what it co-evolved with. So Manchurian ash is able to defend itself against attack by emerald ash borer. Blue ash is a species that's native to North America. It's very rare in Canada, and it has demonstrated resistance to EAB when it's been challenged by it in the lab. And then mountain ash, which a lot of people are familiar with, it's a common sort of horticulture tree. It's not a host to emerald ash borer, because despite the name, it's not actually an ash tree. It's Sorbus, so it's actually a completely different genus. It's more closely related to apples and roses, so it can't be attacked by an emerald ash borer. People are always worried. They ask us, is it going to kill my mountain ash? We're like, no, that's the only ash it's not going to kill. So. Let's talk a little bit about the attack and the damage that it causes. So evidence suggests that the emerald ash borer attacks the tree from the top down. So the first attacks occur up in the crown of the tree, and populations build up there and begin moving down. And in active infestations, this process can take, if in a new infestation, this can take a long time for it to kill a tree because the population isn't very big. It takes a long time to eat that phloem resource, and it takes a long time for it to be noticed. When the populations are big, that tree killing process can take just 2 or 3 years. Why they attack the top of the tree isn't 100% clear. It's probably behavioral adaptation, because they like to be in nice, warm, sunny areas, and that's up in the top of the crown of the tree, so they hang out up there. And we also know that they like to, when they re-attack the same tree year after year, but they attack below the previous year's damage. So as they sort of attack and they move their way down the tree, and as they're moving their way down the tree, they're girdling it and killing it slowly. So small population, that takes a long time. Big population, doesn't take very long for it to kill the whole tree. And so that process of killing the tree leads to branches dying and the crowns losing leaves and water sprouts forming at the bottom of the tree. And those are the signs and symptoms that people notice of, hey, something's wrong with my ash tree, something's killing it. But by the time you've actually noticed that, the bug is well on its way to actually killing the tree. So, and this just sort of illustrates that process. Depending on the size of the tree, that can take different amounts of time. So in a small tree on the top, that's the same tree over about 18 months. So in the spring and then in the fall of the same year is the middle picture, and then D is the spring of the next year, so it didn't leaf out very much. Whereas you look at a large tree, that was the spring, and then later in the fall, and then the summer the next year. So you see with a bigger tree, it takes a lot longer just because there's a lot more phloem there for that insect to have to eat in order for the tree to start to see damage. And so the ultimate result of that is apparent in cities when you see dead and dying trees. And if you're all from Ottawa or Gatineau, you'll have seen the dead and dying trees on the streets. And in woodlots and forests, which is where we do a lot of our work, we see damage like this. So all the gray in that picture is dead ash trees. And so that's a significant portion of that canopy is lost. And so we often talk about the economic impacts of emerald ash borer, but there's a lot of ecological impacts as well. I mean, that's habitat for other organisms, that has ecosystem services that are important to people and to ecological communities. So talk a little bit about control. I'm going to talk about sort of natural control things that kill emerald ash borer that are not the biological control agents, and then I'll talk about the biological control agents. And what this picture shows is how EEB die in my lab. So they die in a box, pinned. Well, they're dead first. Then we stick a pin through, then we stick them in the box. But I have lots, and so I just like the picture. Anyway, so one thing, because it's Canada, everybody asks about what's the effect of climate, what's the effect of cold on Emerald Ash Borer. We know cold, we know Emerald Ash Borer can survive down to minus 30. So some of the very early work that was done at Western University showed that they can survive minus 30. So what that means is Emerald Ash Borer can probably survive in Edmonton. So certainly if you can survive in an Edmonton winter, I lived through a couple of Edmonton winters. If you can survive that, you can survive anything. So Ottawa is fine, Quebec City is fine, right? That winter is not a limiting feature of, at least of the pupil states. That's the stage that was tested. We don't know about the other stages. Some work in the U.S. has showed that you can get mortality of Emerald Ash Borer in logs at slightly hot, warmer temperatures, minus 20 or minus 30, and so there's evidence that perhaps there's differential effects. And what this does is at least different predictions about the effect of sort of winter's cold on EAB populations, what will be the effect of killing populations and keeping them suppressed. And then you can stack on top of that the effect of climate change, and we don't know anything about that when it comes to Emerald Ash Borer. So, talk a little bit about tree resistance. So ash, native North American ash, appears to possess a very weak ability to defend itself against small amounts of Emerald Ash Borer attack. And what we've shown in my lab is that when populations are very small larvae can actually be killed by the tree. But when populations get bigger, the tree can't defend itself anymore, and Emerald Ash Borer is able to kill the tree. And so what this picture shows is that what a tree's response to Emerald Ash Borer is. So that when a tree's wounded, it tries to heal over that wound. And so an ash tree can do that with a couple Emerald Ash Borer, but it can't do that when it's being attacked by hundreds and thousands of them. It doesn't possess the ability to mobilize itself fast enough. But the fact that tree resistance exists, and we know that there's resistance in Manchurian ash and in the ash that Emerald Ash Borer co-evolved with, that has led to active research and breeding programs to try to breed resistant North American ash or North American ash with Manchurian ash and other Asian ash species that are resistant, so that if at some point we can begin to reintroduce ash to the landscape. We can talk a little bit about predators. There are non-insect things and insect things that eat Emerald Ash Borer. Woodpeckers have been reported to cause very significant mortality in some stands that are attacked by Emerald Ash Borer, but they're mostly predators in the large later instars of EAB, so large larvae or those pupae and prepupae that are spending the winter underneath the trees. So you might see on ash trees the sort of holes where the woodpeckers have tried to feed and have tried to eat them, and they can knock down a certain portion of the population, but sort of it can be very patchy. Squirrels will feed on larvae and pupae, although we don't know a lot about their impacts. And some native insects, like this big predatory wasp in the right-hand image, are known to feed on adult Emerald Ash Borer. And this particular wasp is called Cerceris fumipennis. And it's actually been incorporated into a citizen science program to monitor for new infestations of EAB, and that came out of some work in the University of Guelph. And basically, these little wasps, like, they build nests in sandy areas like Ball Diamonds. And so people actually sit and watch the little ground nests to see what these wasps bring back. Because they fly out into the woods and they'll find little beetles and they bring them back. And then people will steal them from the wasp and see if it's Emerald Ash Borer or not. And people have used this to try and find if new populations are established. There's a number of chemical options available. And these are all chemicals that can be injected into a tree that act to either kill EAB larvae or adults as they feed on the leaves. One of these, the triazin or azadiractin, was developed actually by the Canadian Forest Service and commercialized by a company called Bioforest out of Sault Ste. Marie, and it's in widespread use throughout Canada. The other chemicals, acephate is an organophosphate, and imidacloprid is one of the neonicotinoids. These are all registered in Canada. They're available at different places. They kill bugs. They're only really effective and they're only really optional in high-value trees. We're not going to use this in woodlots to shoot hundreds of thousands of trees, because you actually have to physically inject it into every tree, right? So it's something you can use at your house or something you can use at your golf course. It's not something we're going to use out in the woods to suppress Emerald Ash Borer. So the last thing I'm going to talk about is parasitoids, and this is going to be sort of a bridge into the last part of the talk on the biological control program. So it's important here to sort of understand what a parasitoid is, as they're often confused with parasites. So a parasite is something that lives inside another organism and reduces its vitality. So you know what a tapeworm is? Tapeworm, parasite, okay? The parasitoid is an organism that attacks, develops, and then eventually kills its host. So that's a parasitoid. So everybody's seen the movie Aliens, right? Or the new one, the old one, the new one. So the thing in Alien, parasitoid. This is my colleague Laura Timms in her Halloween costume from a couple years ago. as Ripley with the alien coming out of her. She actually did some of the first work on Emerald Ash Borer and biological control, and so this is sort of what this is sort of her area of interest. But that's what the EB parasitoids do. They eat the larva and then they come out, right? So the larva dies, you get a parasitoid at the end instead of an adult Emerald Ash Borer. So there are native parasitoids, native to North America, that have attacked, that have switched to and now attack Emerald Ash Borer. So the one on the left is Antennacolis caporetti, and the other one is Phasgonophorus sulcata. These don't have common names, so I have to switch to my Latin now. Both are parasitic wasps that attack the larva. So these are native North America. At some point since the 1990s, they've switched to attack Emerald Ash Borer. They've not been shown to reduce the populations of the insect, and in general, we tend to find them in large numbers in association with declining populations of EEB. So they're sort of late to the party. They do eat a lot of EEB, but they're not there in time to suppress the population. There's some work being done by graduate students at the University of Toronto to see if these can be integrated into biological control programs by sort of getting them to areas early by sort of moving logs and this kind of thing. And that's an area of active research. And that's sort of a bridge into talk about the biological control program, and now I will finally get to the work that's done at NCC land. So this has been sort of a long lead up to why you actually, I've come all the way from Sault Ste. Marie to tell you what we've done. But before I do, I'm going to sort of introduce one more concept to explain the biological control program. So how much time do I have? Super, all right. I guess there. Nine? Okay. I'll start talking slower. Okay. If my wife is watching on YouTube, she's like, he's talking too fast. So the research being done by Natural Resources Canada on the NCC lands is part of a larger classical biological control program that was begun by the U.S. Forest Service. So a lot of the initial research, a lot of the baseline ecological information that we have comes from our colleagues with the U.S. Forest Service. And classical biological control is a management tactic. Okay. Is a management tactic deployed against invasive insects that works kind of like this. So I'm going to walk you through a couple slides just to show you how it works. So what we're going to do for a minute is we're going to pretend that there's an insect native to North America that doesn't cause any problems here because it's controlled by our native biological control agents, our native parasites and parasitoids and predators. So, and biological controls can be anything, but in classical biological control, we're just talking about insects that control other insects. So what happens is this insect gets introduced into another place. So let's just say Australia, because that works with the map. If you know anything about biogeography, this isn't actually possible, and it probably wouldn't survive. But we'll just pretend, because it makes a nice big arrow. So once it gets to Australia, it increases in abundance and becomes a pest. So like Emerald Ash Borer has become in North America. So what researchers do when that happens is they go back to where the insect comes from. First of all, they figure out where it came from, then they go back to where the insect came from. They start to look for the native natural controls that control that insect in its home range. And they collect them, and then they go back to where they came from. So they go back, they take them home, and then they do a bunch of science, and there's a big bunch of regulatory processes. And at the end of all that, if you're successful, then you release those biological control agents out into the environment in the hopes of establishing that effect, that control, that natural control in the new range, so that now you have the same kind of ecological system in the invaded range as you do in the home range. That's sort of the goal in a very short version of what classical biological control is. That's what we're trying to do with the introduced parasitoids for the EEB biological control program. So. And just as an aside, this is something that the Canadian Forest Service has been doing for a long time. One of our second Dominion entomologist was a guy named C. Gordon Hewitt, who worked here in Ottawa. And that was what he was hired to do. He was an entomologist trained in the UK, was brought over to combat something called larch sawfly. And so this is something we have a lot of experience doing. We've been doing it for a long time. And this is just sort of carrying on from that history of doing biological control in forest systems in Canada. So, I'm just going to walk you through the five species that are being introduced for EAB control in North America. All are from the native range in China, and all were developed by the U.S. Forest Service for their release program, and we're building on top of that. So the first three that I'm showing you are larval parasitoids. The one on the left is Spathia sigrilli, and it was approved for release in Canada, but it was later determined that it doesn't survive well above about 40 degrees north. It doesn't like the cold, so it's never been introduced into Canada. Spathia gallinae, which is the middle one, is a related species from the Russian Far East that matches our climate better. It was approved for release in Canada in the spring of this year, and there was the first small release was done this year in Ontario. And the one on the right is Tetrastochus planipinnisi, and it was released released in North America since 2009, and in Canada since 2013 in southern Ontario and in Quebec. So these two species now are egg parasitoids. So just to give an idea of scale, that white blob in the left-hand image, that's an emerald ash borer egg. So that's 1 to 2 millimeters wide. That's an adult wasp laying its egg inside an emerald ash borer egg, just to give you an idea of how tiny that is. So this is smaller than the fruit fly than you have that, you know, buzzes around your kitchen, right, if you don't clean up the bananas. Ubius agrilli was an egg parasitoid. The one on the left is Ubius agrilli. It was first released in 2009 in the States, and then it's been released since 2015 in Canada. The other species, which is Ubius primerskiensis, is a new one that's been discovered in China and is still being assessed for release in North America. So it's only in the lab in the States. Just want to give you an idea of what's involved in rearing these and producing these parasitoids. This is sort of not a small, you know, corner of the lab operation. This is a multi-million dollar facility that the U.S. Forest Service built in Brighton, Michigan, just to grow EEB parasitoids. That's all they do there. So they have full-time staff who grow and maintain parasitoids. So that image on the left is sort of the mini bolts where they rear EEB larvae and then let the parasitoids attack them, and that's what they eventually use to release them. Then we've got some growth chambers and rearing drums. So this is big time science in turn to do this kind of work. To do the releases of the parasitoids, conversely, it's kind of a low-tech operation. So there's two ways to do it. You see that little log hanging from the tree there? That contains Tetrastochus planipinnisi. So basically, you take that to the woods, nail it to a tree, and the wasps emerge and then go off and attack the emerald ash borers that are in the tree. The thing on the right, the little cylinder, is called an ubinator. So what inside that is for releasing Ubius, the Ubius ubinator. Inside there is a coffee filter that has emerald ash borer eggs on it that Ubius has attacked. So it has parasitized eggs in there. You hang that out in the woods, Ubius comes out and goes attacks the emerald ash borer eggs on the tree. And that's how you release, and this is how the releases have been done on NCC lands and then throughout the rest of North America. And releases are kind of exciting, so sometimes they track the media, so you get bigger people show up. I think this is CTV Ottawa, maybe? I'm not sure. I think this was taken. The woman in the picture is my colleague, Krista Ryle. And this is all her research I've been showing. She got to go to Calgary this week. I get to come to Ottawa and talk to you. So this is her stuff. I'm just presenting it to you lovely people. So Natural Resources Canada has been making the releases since 2013 at these 11 sites. And I've just circled the two there that are on NCC land up in this area. And this year, we've also made our first releases in northern Ontario, just outside Sault Ste. Marie. So we started sort of working on our own populations up north. And these are my one data slide for the entire talk. And this just shows you the progression of releases over time through Canada. So what each row is a site, and then the number is either the number of Tetrastochus or the number of Ubius that have been released at each site in each year. So the in the purple box are the two NCC sites. So about 6,200 parasitoids at Conroy and something like 5,900 parasitoids, 6,000 Tetrastochus and in Gatineau. And then about 3,200 Ubius. These sort of approximate counts because I showed you the releases. It's very difficult to sort of sit there and see how many little wasps come out of the ubinator. So it's an estimate based on parasitism rates and number of eggs laid. So what's the impact? That's the question we always get asked, right? Does it work? That's the stage in research where we're at. We know Tetrastochus has established at the Gatineau sites because after the wasps have been released, we come back the next year, cut down some trees, take them to Sault Ste. Marie and see what comes out of them, and we've got Tetrastochus coming out of these standing trees from Gatineau. So we know that it's established. We know there's a population there. What we have to do then is sort of wait to see if it actually starts to reduce the population, and that's just where we're at with the first releases that we did. Okay, first releases that we did in southern Ontario a couple of years ago, and we're not at that stage with Ubius. So we don't actually know if it's working or not. All we know is that we can successfully introduce parasitoids into Canada. So let's end with a little plug. This is part of our lab in Sault Ste. Marie. We started growing our own wasps up, and this is the first year that we've actually produced Canadian-made EAB parasitoids in Sault Ste. Marie. And so you see the picture again from the CBC, same picture, same bug. Same two CBC guys from Sudbury. We're sort of proud of this. We have this awesome lab in Sault Ste. Marie. We can grow EB parasitoids, and our hope is that we can sort of start producing our own so that we can start doing our more releases in Canada and supporting our own research program. So I'll stop talking there. That's the summary of my talk. I suppose you can take a picture if you want. I'll just answer questions there, if that's okay? All right. Hello.
Hi. What about armyworms? You see cobwebs with caterpillars inside.
Sure.
It's giving me a problem, and I just recently found out that they're having the same problem in Africa with armyworms. Is this imported from Canada, or anyway, what happened to our? Do the birds not like eating them, or what's the situation?
The armyworms.
Well, I'm not sure the ones we have in Canada are the same thing, but they're full like a tent of webs, and
sure.
It's full of caterpillars inside.
So what you're describing sort of sounds like forest tent caterpillar, which is a defoliating pest, a pest in that eats sort of our hardwood trees, the leaves of our hardwood trees. There's a related thing called armyworm that's mostly a pest of agricultural crops. And I know this is where my knowledge sort of ends because I stop at trees. But I know it's been introduced to Africa and I know it's been a big problem. But beyond that, I wouldn't know more than Google.
These insects, are they native to Canada?
Which one?
The ones that make these tents with filled with caterpillars inside.
If you're talking about tent caterpillar, yeah, tent caterpillar is native to North America.
And that's not the same thing as armyworms.
Different thing, yeah, different thing. Okay. I don't know how, switch mics, I guess?
Sure. So you mentioned that we're working on crossbreeding trees to have a more resistant sapling?
Yeah, it's a research area, not one that the CFS is doing. But yeah.
But someone is.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if I have saplings that have germinated under my ash trees that
right.
are now gone, should I be fostering those, or what is the scientific background?
So my guess would be the ones you're seeing come up underneath your ash tree are coming up from the roots of the tree that died.
I have a lot that germinated as well.
Okay.
Like I can tell the difference between the two.
Okay.
And I have tons that have germinated, but I've been offering them to people, and they're like, "Oh God, I don't want any ash trees," because they're mourning the loss of their ash trees.
Sure.
So I don't know if I should be growing them, or if that would potentially provide a habitat later on the road to have the same problem cycle up again.
So I don't think there's anything wrong with growing them.
Yeah.
The question is, are they resistant to emerald ash borer? Probably not. They're the offspring of the tree that died,
yeah.
And so. By the fact that your tree died meant it probably wasn't resistant to emerald ash borer. There's no harm in growing them. What we've seen has happened in places like Windsor, like where the earliest emerald ash borer infestations were, is the trees get to be about that big, and then the EB find them. So they're still sort of around, and they will still attack those trees, and unfortunately they will kill them. But in the meantime, if you like having it, there's nothing wrong with having it there. Because what probably happens when EAB sort of kills a lot of the trees is the population drops, right? It's still around, you're still not seeing it, but it's probably still there, right? So you're just sort of, you're not doing anything harmful by having it growing. And if you like having it, it's not a problem. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Awesome, thanks.
Time for just one more question.
You said that the Asian species of ash are resistant.
Yes.
Is it because they produce chemicals that the bug doesn't like to eat or that actually kill the bug?
They have a chemical defense system that they can resist attack by emerald ash borer.
Would it be possible to using genetic engineering to breed that into North American trees?
Yeah, and that's sort of the state of the art technology, is to figure out what genes are responsible for that response, that ability to defend itself, and somehow either through conventional breeding or through other technologies produce trees that possess those genes.
Thank you.
Welcome.
thanks to Dr. McCoy. Notre prochain, c'est Yann Surget-Gorba. Puis on va juste attendre que sa présentation soit montée.
Donc, bonsoir à tous. So I'm going to do the presentation in French, but if you want to ask questions in English, it's fine after. Donc aujourd'hui, je vais vous parler d'une méthode d'inventaire de biodiversité qui est basée sur des petits fragments d'ADN qui sont dans l'eau, en fait. Donc tout d'abord, je vais vous décrire un peu les outils de biologie moléculaire qu'on peut utiliser en écologie et en conservation. Donc décrire un peu qu'est-ce que c'est et qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire avec. Et après, je vous montrerai deux applications, qui est l'identification d'espèces par ce qu'on appelle des codes-barres ADN et l'utilisation aussi de ces séquences d'ADN qui sont dans l'environnement pour faire des inventaires de biodiversité. Donc ça, c'est une étude que j'ai réalisée dans le parc de la Gatineau. Donc tout d'abord, les outils moléculaires qu'on va utiliser en écologie et conservation. Donc tous ces outils sont basés sur l'ADN. Donc l'ADN, en fait, c'est une molécule qui est présente dans toutes les cellules vivantes sous la forme de chromosomes. Et en fait, c'est le support de l'information génétique. Donc cette information va être passée de génération en génération. Et de temps en temps, il va y avoir des modifications, donc des mutations. Et ça va nous permettre, quand on lit cette information, de retracer l'histoire des individus, en fait. Donc, qu'est-ce qu'on peut faire avec cette information? Donc, il y a plusieurs choses. On peut utiliser ça pour distinguer des espèces, en fait. Des fois, il y a des espèces qui ont l'air différentes, mais on n'est pas sûr si c'est juste des types écologiques différents ou si c'est vraiment des espèces différentes. Donc, on peut regarder leur ADN et voir si c'est vraiment différent. On peut utiliser ça pour identifier des espèces. Donc, ça, on y reviendra plus tard. On peut utiliser l'ADN aussi pour détecter des espèces dans l'environnement. Donc ça, c'est pareil, on en parlera plus tard. Et après, il y a deux autres applications qui sont plus pour la biologie de la conservation, en fait. On peut utiliser l'ADN pour mesurer les liens, les migrations qu'il y a entre populations pour voir si, par exemple, la fragmentation des habitats va réduire les flux géniques et isoler les populations. Et on peut utiliser ça aussi pour définir des unités de gestion. En fait, souvent, dans une espèce, il y a des populations qui sont plus ou moins séparées, qui sont utiles de gérer séparément. On ne va pas mélanger des choses qui viennent d'endroits trop différents. Et donc, c'est pareil, l'ADN va nous apporter les informations qui permettent de gérer les populations qu'on veut conserver. Donc, d'abord, je vais vous parler de la résolution d'incertitudes taxonomiques. Donc, pour ça, je vais prendre l'exemple d'une petite grenouille qui est au Québec, donc la rainette faux-grillon. Donc, on a deux espèces ici au Québec. La rainette faux-grillon boréale, qui est présente dans le nord-ouest du Québec, et la rainette faux-grillon de l'ouest, qui est présente dans le sud du Québec, donc ici, en Montérégie, et elle est présente aussi plus au sud, en Ontario. Donc, récemment, en 2015, il y a eu des chercheurs de l'Université de Montréal qui ont étudié un peu la génétique de ces deux espèces. Et d'abord, ce qu'ils ont vu, c'est qu'en effet, les deux espèces sont bien distinctes génétiquement. Donc, ce que vous avez sur cette figure, en fait, c'est ce qu'on appelle un arbre phylogénétique. Donc, ça va montrer la distance entre les individus. Et on peut voir qu'il y a deux groupes. Donc, un groupe en bleu qui correspond à la rainette faux-grillon boréale et un groupe en rouge qui correspond à la rainette faux-grillon de l'ouest. Donc, ces deux groupes bien séparés, on peut les distinguer facilement à partir de leur ADN. Mais ce qui a été plus étonnant, c'est que l'ensemble des individus qui ont été collectés au Québec et en Ontario, en fait, semblent appartenir à la mauvaise espèce. C'est-à-dire qu'on croyait que c'était la rainette faux-grillon de l'Ouest, mais ils se branchent tous, ils se groupent tous dans le groupe bleu, qui est la rainette faux-grillon boréale. Donc, ces résultats ont été confirmés par mes propres études. Donc, moi, en fait, j'ai travaillé sur un autre gène, mais on obtient à peu près les mêmes résultats. Donc, ce que vous avez ici, c'est les séquences d'ADN qui correspondent, en fait, que j'ai pris dans les bases de données génétiques publiques. Donc, j'ai pris toutes les séquences qui venaient du Québec ou de l'Ontario. Ensuite, je les ai groupées, comme tout à l'heure. J'ai fait un arbre pour voir comment ils se groupaient. Et là encore, on peut observer deux groupes, donc le groupe bleu qui est encore la rainette faux-grillon boréal et le groupe rouge qui est la rainette faux-grillon de l'ouest. En noir, c'est une autre espèce, c'est la rainette crucifère que j'ai mis là comme un groupe extérieur en fait pour comparer. Et là encore, on voit que toutes les individus qui viennent du Québec sont dans le groupe bleu, du Québec et de l'Ontario en fait. Donc ces deux études confirment qu'au Québec, on a uniquement la rainette faux-grillon boréal, contrairement à ce qu'on pensait. Donc là, juste une petite parenthèse, parce qu'en fait, les populations du sud du Québec sont protégées, sont considérées comme menacées dans la loi sur les espèces en péril au Canada. Le changement de nom, là, n'a pas vraiment d'impact, parce qu'elle est définie comme les populations des Grands Lacs, du Saint-Laurent et du Bouclier canadien. Donc c'est basé sur la géographie. Donc toutes les populations qui sont ici sont automatiquement protégées, même si ce n'est pas le bon nom, si ce n'est pas l'espèce qu'on croyait être. Donc une autre application de l'ADN, c'est on peut utiliser ça pour détecter des espèces aquatiques. Donc comment on fait ça? En fait, l'ADN qui est présent dans toutes les cellules, il va être aussi relâché dans l'environnement. On perd des cellules, de la peau, des poils, des plumes pour les oiseaux. Enfin, tout le temps, on est en train de perdre de l'ADN. Donc, dans notre environnement, notre ADN est présent. Donc, si on prend de l'eau et qu'on regarde dedans, il va y avoir l'ADN des espèces qui vivent dans le milieu aquatique. Donc, l'article que je présente là, c'est un article de 2008 qui est un des premiers à avoir utilisé cette méthode pour détecter des espèces. Et en fait, là, il cherchait à détecter une espèce que vous connaissez bien ici, le wawaron, donc c'est la grosse grenouille taureau, qui en France est une espèce invasive. Donc, en fait, il voulait la détecter de façon précoce pour pouvoir l'enlever des sites où elle a été introduite. Donc, comme ça, ils ont réussi, avec cette méthode, à détecter l'ADN dans des lacs où ils ne savaient pas encore qu'elle était présente. Donc, quand elle est présente, quand elle est abondante, en fait, elle est facile à voir, elle chante, on l'entend. Mais quand elle est à faible densité, quand elle vient d'être introduite, ça peut être plus difficile à détecter. Donc là, en fait, ils ont réussi à détecter 3 sites sur lesquels ils ne savaient pas encore que l'espèce avait été introduite. Et après, ils ont pu la trouver et essayer de l'éliminer. Donc cette méthode est très sensible, ça permet de détecter des espèces rares, donc des espèces invasives qui sont au début du stade de l'invasion, donc c'est là que vraiment on peut faire quelque chose, comme disait sur le... je ne me rappelle plus le nom en français, la grille du frêne, voilà. La grille du frêne, quand on la détecte, c'est trop tard, là, elle est déjà à grande population, donc l'intérêt des espèces invasives, c'est les éliminer quand elles sont à basse densité. Donc des méthodes génétiques peuvent permettre de les détecter très précocement. Donc une autre application, c'est l'identification d'espèces par l'utilisation de ce qu'on appelle des codes-barres ADN. Donc sur la planète, on estime qu'il y a entre 10 et 15 millions d'espèces. Avec la crise de la biodiversité qu'on a maintenant, en fait, on a besoin de recenser ces espèces, voir où elles sont avant qu'elles disparaissent. Le problème, c'est qu'on a de moins en moins d'experts taxonomistes qui sont capables de reconnaître et d'identifier les espèces basées sur leur apparence physique, sur leur morphologie. Donc cette expertise, qui était très courante avant, elle se perd de plus en plus. Les universités n'embauchent plus des taxonomistes. Donc on perd cette expertise. Et même quand on a l'expertise, il y a beaucoup d'espèces en fait, qui sont trop proches, qu'on ne peut pas distinguer, qui sont très, très difficiles à distinguer sur la base de leur apparence physique. Et donc, on a besoin d'une autre façon pour les distinguer. Et enfin, il y a les espèces pour lesquelles on ne peut distinguer que les adultes. C'est-à-dire les jeunes n'ont pas les caractères qui permettent de les identifier. Et donc, quand on fait un inventaire, souvent, la plupart des individus qu'on va capturer sont des juvéniles, et ceux-là, on doit les éliminer parce qu'on ne sait pas les reconnaître. Donc, en fait, c'est ça, comme je disais, là, on fait face à une crise de la biodiversité, on a une perte très accélérée des espèces. Donc, on est en train de faire des inventaires de biodiversité, mais à cause de toutes ces contraintes, on est souvent obligé de travailler sur des groupes qui sont bien connus, donc des oiseaux, ou si on travaille sur les insectes, on va travailler sur les coléoptères qui sont bien connus. Et tout ce qui n'est pas trop connu, on va le laisser de côté. Donc, en fait, ça fait un gros biais dans les inventaires de biodiversité. Donc là, c'est juste un petit schéma pour vous montrer quand on fait un inventaire de biodiversité, qu'est-ce qu'on va faire? D'abord, on va aller sur le terrain, essayer d'attraper des espèces, puis on va les ramener dans le laboratoire, les trier, et après, on va essayer de les identifier sur la base de leur apparence physique. Donc, comme j'ai dit avant, ça peut être difficile, voire impossible pour certaines espèces. Et même quand c'est possible, ça prend beaucoup d'expertise. Il faut avoir des experts qui savent reconnaître les espèces. Et ça prend aussi énormément de temps. Ne serait-ce que pour le tri, ça va prendre beaucoup de temps. Donc, pour pallier à ces problèmes, on a un biologiste, Paul Hébert, qui, de l'Université de Guelph, en Ontario, qui, au début des années 2000, a proposé l'idée d'utiliser les séquences d'ADN pour identifier les espèces. Donc, lui, il appelait ça le DNA barcoding. Donc, on va utiliser une séquence d'ADN et on va dire cette séquence correspond à telle espèce. Donc, l'avantage de cette méthode, c'est que, comme on a vu tout à l'heure, l'ADN est présent dans tous les organismes vivants. On peut utiliser un marqueur standard qui va servir de référence. Et une fois qu'on a cette séquence, en fait, une fois qu'on a choisi ce marqueur standard, ben, on a besoin de le lire et on n'a besoin d'aucune expertise taxonomique. On n'a pas besoin de savoir quelle espèce on a là, on a juste besoin de lire son ADN. Et aussi, vu que l'ADN va être le même dans un œuf, dans un jeune ou dans un adulte, on va pouvoir identifier tous les stades de toutes les espèces, en fait. Donc là, un petit exemple, c'est des séquences. En fait, si on combine ce que je vous ai dit tout à l'heure sur l'ADN qui est présent dans l'environnement, donc ce qu'on appelle l'ADN environnemental, si on prend un échantillon d'eau, on va trouver des séquences, on va lire ce code barre standard, et à partir de ça, on va essayer de déterminer quelles sont les espèces présentes. Donc là, j'ai pris un exemple de deux séquences que j'ai trouvées dans le parc de la Gatineau, dans un lac, et qui appartiennent à deux poissons-chats, la barbotte brune et la barbotte jaune. Et en fait, si vous regardez, ça, c'est la séquence d'ADN avec quatre lettres, en fait, et c'est ça qui va faire le code barre. Donc, si vous regardez, ça a l'air très similaire, mais en fait, les petites astérisques, là, ça correspond à des différences. Donc, il y a quatre différences, quatre mutations entre ces deux séquences, ce qui fait à peu près 10%, là, il y a à peu près 40 lettres. Et 10% de différence sur ça, c'est considérable. En général, on considère qu'autour de 2%, plus de 2%, on a affaire à des espèces différentes. Donc là, à 10%, on peut dire que oui, c'est bien des espèces différentes et on peut les identifier, on peut les séparer sans problème. Donc si on a ces séquences, si on a la première, on va savoir que c'est la barbotte brune. Si c'est la deuxième, c'est la barbotte jaune. Donc, bien sûr, pour faire ça, on a besoin de bases de données. Donc, une séquence, si on a une séquence toute seule, ça ne va rien nous apporter. Il faut qu'on sache à quelle espèce cette séquence appartient. Donc, il y a cette base de données, donc il y en a d'autres, mais cette base de données qui est maintenue par l'Institut de la biodiversité de l'Ontario, aussi à Guelph, où les chercheurs, en fait, donc, on va, quand on travaille sur une espèce, on connaît nos espèces, on est spécialiste de cette espèce, on va pouvoir séquencer le code barre et dire, voilà, moi j'ai cette espèce, donc je mets une photo dans la base de données et je sais que cette espèce, elle a ce code barre. Donc maintenant, je ne sais plus combien exactement, mais il y a plusieurs millions de codes barres qui sont disponibles là, dans cette base de données. Donc après, les chercheurs, quand ils ont une séquence, ils ne savent pas qu'est-ce qu'ils ont? Ils ont un insecte, par exemple, ils ne savent pas l'identifier. Ils vont séquencer le code barre, le mettre dans la base de données, et ça va ressortir. Si elle est présente dans la base de données, ça va dire, voilà, c'est telle espèce. Ou alors, si elle n'y est pas, il dit, on ne sait pas. Le plus proche, c'est ça, mais c'est trop loin, on ne peut pas dire que c'est la même espèce. Donc ça, c'est vraiment le plus important. Donc on a encore besoin des taxonomistes là, pour mettre les données dans la base de données. Comme je vous montrerai après, ici au Canada, on est bien lotis. Parce que l'utilisation des codes barres ADN ont démarré ici. Donc, il y a eu beaucoup d'investissements au Canada, de Génome Canada et tout ça, pour développer les bases de données. Donc, la plupart des espèces, beaucoup d'espèces canadiennes sont déjà présentes dans les bases de données, ce qui n'était pas le cas avant. Je travaillais en Chine. 98% des séquences, on ne peut pas les identifier, elles ne sont pas dans les bases de données. Donc là, ici, on a vraiment de la chance au Canada. Donc là, par exemple, sur ce tableau, j'ai essayé de regrouper toutes les séquences pour les espèces québécoises. Je travaille au Québec, donc j'ai regroupé tout ce qui était disponible pour les espèces québécoises. Donc au niveau des vertébrés, il manque seulement deux espèces de mammifères et six espèces d'oiseaux. Donc on a vraiment une très bonne couverture. Pour les invertébrés, c'est plus difficile à dire parce que déjà, on n'a pas de liste d'espèces exhaustive et il y a beaucoup d'espèces qui ne sont probablement pas encore décrites. En fait. On découvre toujours de nouvelles espèces d'insectes ou de vers. C'est des choses moins bien connues. Donc, en fait, après avoir construit cette base de données, j'ai voulu l'utiliser justement pour faire un inventaire de la diversité aquatique qu'on trouve dans le parc de la Gatineau et quelques terrains urbains de la CCN situés au Québec. Donc, en fait, j'ai travaillé avec des bénévoles de l'association Les Amis du parc de la Gatineau pour collecter des échantillons. Donc, on a collecté 91 sites sur l'ensemble du parc, différentes dates. Et la première chose, c'est on va chercher de l'eau. Donc là, en fait, on a utilisé deux méthodes principales. Soit on va filtrer l'eau et après regarder ce qui reste sur le filtre. Ou alors on va prendre de l'eau et précipiter en fait, l'ADN qui est dans cette eau. Donc c'est un peu les deux méthodes qu'on a utilisées ici. Donc, les résultats qu'on a obtenus, une fois qu'on a tous ces échantillons, donc je crois qu'il y avait 180 échantillons au total en comptant les différentes dates, on a obtenu plus de 15 millions de séquences en fait, d'ADN. Mais sur ces 15 millions de séquences, il y en a beaucoup qui sont les mêmes, qui sont répétées de nombreuses fois. Donc, en fait, on en a identifié 4700, plus de 4700 qui sont uniques. En fait, c'est des séquences biologiques qui sont présentes dans l'ensemble des sites. Là, c'est... Et sur ces 4700 séquences, donc là, c'est les séquences qu'on a, on les a comparées à la base de données et on a pu en identifier 1000. Ça veut dire qu'il y a quand même 3000 séquences là-dedans, on ne sait pas ce que c'est. Ce n'est pas dans les bases de données. Et sur ces 1000 séquences qu'on a pu identifier, on a trouvé 243 espèces. Donc là-dessus, sur ces 243, il y en a près d'une centaine qui n'ont jamais été recensées avant dans le parc de la Gatineau. Donc ça apporte quand même de nouvelles informations sur la biodiversité du parc. Donc, qu'est-ce qu'on va trouver comme espèce? Donc, on a trouvé quand même une grande diversité d'espèces. On a trouvé 17 espèces d'annélides. Donc, les annélides, c'est les vers, donc les sangsues. Donc, il y a pas mal de sangsues. Et les vers de terre et tout ce qui est vers. Donc, ça, il y en a beaucoup. Surtout, il y a de très grandes quantités de vers dans les échantillons qu'on a trouvés. On a trouvé 6 espèces de mollusques, donc comme ce petit escargot d'eau douce, là, une limnée. Donc on a pu détecter ça. Des crustacés, 16 espèces de crustacés, comme les petites crevettes, les crevettes d'eau douce. Et la majorité de ce qu'on a trouvé, c'est des insectes. Donc vraiment une très, très grande diversité d'insectes. Beaucoup de moustiques, là, on peut. Les mouches noires, toutes ces petites bêtes, là, qui sont très agréables. Donc 149 espèces d'insectes ont été détectées, dont cette demoiselle là qui est illustrée. Au niveau des poissons, on a identifié 20 espèces de poissons plus une lamproie. Donc j'ai mis là, c'est pas un poisson, mais c'est quand même dans ces milieux aquatiques. Donc la lamproie qu'on a trouvée, c'est la lamproie de l'Est. C'est une espèce qui fréquente la région, mais qui n'avait jamais été identifiée dans le parc de la Gatineau. Elle est connue dans la rivière des Outaouais et dans la rivière Gatineau, mais dans le parc, elle n'avait jamais été recensée. Tout à l'heure, on avait parlé de la barbotte jaune, là, je vous avais montré. Donc cette barbotte jaune est une espèce en péril là, du parc. Et c'est une espèce qui n'avait été trouvée que 5 fois auparavant dans le parc de la Gatineau. Et là, on a identifié deux nouveaux sites, en fait. C'est des sites où on l'a trouvée et elle n'était pas connue dans ces sites auparavant. Donc, c'est encore de nouvelles informations pour le parc. Et puis, il y a des espèces qui sont beaucoup plus communes, là. Donc, j'ai mis le crapé soleil, c'est une petite espèce très colorée qui est un peu partout. Donc, celle-là, on l'a trouvée dans pratiquement tous les lacs qu'on a échantillonnés. Et on a aussi trouvé des espèces qui ont été introduites au début du XXe siècle illégalement en fait, dans le parc pour la pêche sportive, comme les achigans. En fait. Donc, ils ont été introduits dans différents lacs. Et en effet, on les a détectés dans cinq lacs du parc. En ce qui concerne les reptiles et amphibiens, On a trouvé 8 espèces d'amphibiens. Donc tout à l'heure, on avait parlé de la rainette faux-grillon boréale. Donc avant, on pensait que c'était la faux-grillon de l'Ouest, mais bon, c'est la boréale. Donc là encore, c'est important de détecter cette espèce parce que, c'est, comme on l'a dit tout à l'heure, c'était une espèce menacée. Donc là, on n'a pas trouvé de nouveaux sites, mais on a confirmé des sites qui étaient déjà connus. J'ai mis aussi une photo du wawaron, donc là, qui n'est pas du tout menacé. Là, on l'a trouvé dans pratiquement tous les plans d'eau où on a cherché. Sinon, on a trouvé des tritons, des salamandres, pas mal de choses. Et au niveau reptile, on a trouvé 2 espèces, dont la chélide serpentine, qui est aussi une espèce en péril dans le parc. Donc, encore quelque chose d'intéressant à noter, même si, en fait, elle est assez commune ici. Au niveau fédéral, elle est classée comme préoccupante. Et la deuxième espèce de reptile qu'on a trouvée, c'est la couleuvrier. C'est un petit serpent qui fréquente les milieux aquatiques aussi, qui est assez abondant. Donc au niveau des oiseaux, en fait, on n'a trouvé qu'une seule espèce, le canard col vert ou le mallard. Donc là, juste entre parenthèses, il y a des sites qui étaient assez proches de fermes, mais on a trouvé des poules aussi là-dedans, mais bon, je ne les ai pas inclus dans les espèces aquatiques. Pour les mammifères, c'est pareil, 2 espèces mammifères, des mammifères qui sont très communs, le castor et le rat musqué. Donc là encore, on a trouvé l'humain, beaucoup de séquences humaines, mais qui ne sont pas aquatiques. Et pareil, en bordure de ferme, on a trouvé des vaches. Donc voilà, en fait, c'était un peu pour vous donner un aperçu de cette méthode qui permet de faire des inventaires rapides et qui permet après de poser des questions plus appliquées. Par exemple, tout à l'heure, on parlait de l'introduction des achigans. Donc là, on a pu étudier, je ne l'ai pas présenté là parce que je n'avais pas encore les résultats, mais on a pu étudier l'impact de l'introduction des achigans sur les autres poissons que les achigans mangent. Et il y a tout plein de questions comme ça qu'on peut traiter en écologie à partir de ces inventaires rapides. Donc voilà, je voulais remercier la CCN pour le financement de cette étude, ainsi que les amis du parc de la Gatineau qui ont participé au financement, mais aussi les volontaires des amis du parc de la Gatineau qui m'ont beaucoup aidé pour la collecte des échantillons. Donc le parc de la Gatineau, c'est très grand, et quand on fait ça, en fait, on veut travailler sur une période de temps assez courte. Donc il faut beaucoup de monde qui collecte en même temps si on veut couvrir l'ensemble du parc dans une période de temps restreinte. Et aussi Gabriel Fortin du Service canadien de la faune qui travaille sur un autre programme mais qui a collecté des échantillons d'eau pour moi. Donc merci beaucoup et si vous avez des questions.
Ah oui, bonjour. Vous avez mentionné que vous avez trouvé une espèce invasive à la France dans une lac. Je suis curieux combien d'eau est-ce que vous aviez besoin d'évaluer pour être certain, oui ou non, qu'il y a une espèce invasive.
Voilà. En fait, plus on va utiliser d'eau, plus on aura de chances de détecter la méthode. Donc, j'ai parlé brièvement qu'on a utilisé 2 techniques, une technique de filtration et une technique où on fait juste précipiter l'eau. Donc, la technique où on précipite l'ADN, là, on n'utilise pas beaucoup d'eau. On utilise à peu près 30 millilitres d'eau. Donc, c'est vraiment de petites quantités. Alors que quand on peut filtrer des plus grands volumes, 1 litre ou plus. La méthode de précipitation est moins chère, plus rapide et plus facile logistiquement, mais on a montré quand même que la filtration est plus efficace. On trouve plus d'espèces par la filtration. Donc si on veut détecter une espèce invasive à faible densité, il vaudra mieux passer par la filtration, utiliser un gros volume d'eau pour pouvoir augmenter en fait les chances de détecter l'espèce.
That was really cool. Thank you. Also, did you study any microorganisms and add them to the DNA database?
Usually for microorganisms, we're going to use different markers. You could do it, but with different markers. But I still found some diatoms, for instance, and things like that. But the study was targeted with macro animals, basically. But you could do that.
Possible?
People do that on the soil, for instance, on bacteria and fungi. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, it's the first, they started to do that. This kind of study started with microorganisms because they, you know, they cannot, there are a lot of organisms, microorganisms that cannot be cultivated. So we don't know the diversity, and they used sequences to estimate the diversity of organisms, microorganisms. So it started with them.
So you did your sampling in the summer at one time. Would it be more useful to do samples over a year? And
actually, we did three sampling between May and June. And we found, actually, that the communities were different between the first and the third time we sampled. So yes, if you want to have a good vision of the biodiversity of an area, you would need to do several repeated sampling to make sure you don't miss species. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
So actually, we did three sampling. So the extreme were 1 month different, and we found difference, significant difference between the first and the last. But the middle one wasn't significantly different. So you would need to do every month maybe the sampling.
So ideally, in the end, you would do a full year.
Yeah. Yeah. The release of DNA in the environment is going to be depend on the temperature and the activity of the species. So in winter, we might not find a lot of things. The first sampling we did was around the 5th of May, and we didn't find that many things. And later, we found much more sequences. But it would be interesting to do it all over the year to know what's going on.
Maybe you could use drones or something.
To come collect, yeah.
Oui, bonjour. L'ADN que vous collectez, quel âge pourrait-elle avoir?
Alors, dans l'eau, l'avantage de l'eau, c'est qu'il va dégrader l'ADN assez rapidement. Donc, en 1 ou 2 semaines, il va être dégradé. Donc, ce qu'on trouve, c'est assez récent. Si on travaillait sur le sol, par exemple, ce serait plus compliqué parce que l'ADN, il peut se fixer sur des argiles ou sur du sable et il pourrait rester longtemps. Donc, ce qu'on a dans le sol, ce n'est pas forcément ce qu'on a maintenant, ça peut être des choses qu'on avait avant. Mais dans l'eau, ça, c'est utile pour ça, parce que l'eau va dégrader l'ADN très rapidement.
Vous avez répondu à une de mes questions, c'est est-ce qu'on pouvait faire un inventaire dans sur le sol aussi? Mais j'aimerais ça savoir aussi, pour faire un inventaire faunique dans un système aquatique, c'est quoi l'échelle que tu dirais pour le montant financier pour faire un inventaire, disons, à la pêche versus un outil d'ADN?
Ouais. Ben, en fait, il y a deux réponses à ça. Il y a des études qui ont comparé les deux. Donc, qui ont comparé la pêche électrique, par exemple, dans des rivières avec l'ADN environnemental. Bien sûr, l'analyse des échantillons coûte cher. Mais au point de vue du temps requis, c'est bien inférieur. Donc en fait, si on doit mobiliser une équipe pour aller faire de la pêche électrique, ça va coûter cher en logistique. Et suivant les conditions, on a aussi montré que cette technique était plus sensible. Donc la pêche électrique, bien sûr, suivant le nombre de passages qu'on va faire, on va réussir à avoir pratiquement tout, mais c'est ça, il faut passer au moins 3 fois. C'est des méthodes qui sont en développement là. Donc il y a beaucoup de recherches qui est faite et qui compare justement les méthodes traditionnelles avec ces méthodes là. La plupart des méthodes montrent qu'on trouve plus d'espèces avec l'ADN environnemental. Même si dans ce cas là, moi il y a des espèces que j'ai vues quand j'ai collecté que j'ai pas retrouvées dans l'ADN. Donc c'est pas parfait non plus.
One last question.
Oui. Vous aviez répondu un peu à la question quand vous avez mentionné que l'ADN se fixe à l'argile, ces choses-là. Est-ce que prendre un échantillon, soit par carotte, des sédiments du fond d'un lac, produirait des résultats avec un ADN qui démontrait l'évolution du lac au côté biologique?
Donc, il y a eu des études qui ont été faites. Donc là, c'est pareil, c'est assez contrasté suivant les études. Il y a des études qui ont montré que qui suggéraient que c'était mieux de prendre le sédiment plutôt que l'eau. Okay. Il y en a d'autres qui ont montré le contraire. Donc, il n'y a pas assez pour avoir un consensus. Mais il y a eu des études, par exemple, qui ont été faites sur le pergélisol là, dans l'Arctique, où ils ont fait des carottes dans le sol gelé, et ils ont pu reconstruire la végétation, en fait, à partir de l'ADN jusqu'à 10 000 ans. L'ADN qui était maintenu gelé, en fait, pouvait servir à reconstruire les écosystèmes passés, en fait.
OK.
Merci.
Donc, merci beaucoup, Yann. So our last presenter of the evening is Dr. Margaret Kalachka. And as soon as her presentation is ready, we can go. Thanks.
Good evening. So my presentation is going to be focusing on the Mirabeau peatland. And this is a very special area just outside of Ottawa. And I'm going to take you on a tour from a more remote observation. So we're going to take a look at satellite imagery, some drone imagery, and then I will give you a historical overview of how some of those areas have changed and the kinds of information that we can extract from these very unique data sets. So what you see in the background there is actually, just after sunrise, a very early drone photo looking east, and the Mirabeau peatland would be the area on the left side of the screen. So this area is very special because peatlands are of great importance to Canada as well as globally. So in Canada, we have about 12% of our area that is covered by peatlands, so just over 1 million square kilometers. They are also a very large ecosystem globally. So we are very interested to understand how they are going to adapt and how they are going to change depending on the different kind of stressors that they are going to face over time. And of the different kinds of peatlands in Canada, 75% are bogs. And bogs are going to receive their nutrient and water input from precipitation and deposition. And Mirabeau happens to be a bog as well, so it's a really great study site that is close that we can take a look and see how it has changed over time. And peatlands in general are important because they have a very large amount of carbon that they have accumulated over time. So to give you an example of the distribution of peatlands in Canada, we are most interested in looking at the areas in green because those are the ones that are predominantly bogs. So the other colors are going to give you examples of other types of peatlands and other types of wetlands, but we really are looking at where the bogs are located. And as you can see, Ontario and Quebec have quite a large proportion. So Mirabeau specifically is approximately 28 square kilometers in area. It's just outside of Ottawa, so north of the Ottawa airport, and it would be right on the path if you were driving to Montreal. And the kind of vegetation that we see there is something very common that we would find in other kinds of peatlands as well. So we have some vascular plants, we have mosses, and we also have a few different species of trees interspersed. And Mirabeau also has a drainage ditch that is about 80 years old there on the east side. So some of you may have visited the public boardwalk, a beautiful area to take a walk. You see that in the southern portion of the peatland. And so this is really going to be the study area that I'm going to focus on and take you on a tour. Of course, a very important aspect of Mirabeau are the beavers. And you see that inundated area there that we call the beaver ponds. The beavers are quite able to maintain the water table, and they are very prolific at building their dams. And so they are able to sort of regulate the hydrology quite well in this area. So let's start the aerial tour. And so here we are looking west over the peatland, and you see that same inundated area in the center. The peatland is to the right. We have a closer look of what that would look like in the middle of summer. And it's quite a beautiful area as you have different species coming into flower at different times of year. In this case, this is in June, and you can see some of the areas with some purple flowers. Looking out early morning again, you can see the small changes in microtopography where the vascular plants are growing up a little bit taller than the mosses. Very, very nice in the fog as the sun comes up. In the fall, it's absolutely spectacular when the trees are changing color. It's a beautiful time to visit. and then as well to take a look at the different kind of biodiversity that is present. And here we have all of those orange or bright yellow areas on the screen. Those are the larches. This is what you would see if you were to visit at the end of October. Absolutely beautiful with sort of the darker red moss carpet and then these really bright larch trees interspersed. The white lines that you see are boardwalks, and these are really unique, and they allow us access to be able to study the peatland without damaging it. And also quite beautiful in winter as well. A really nice biodiversity. We're very fortunate to see a porcupine early one morning in April, but it's always a surprise to see what kind of biodiversity we will run into when we go out. And another closer look at the boardwalks. In this case, these boardwalks have been in use for a very long-term experiment that is trying to see how these peatlands will adapt to different fertilization. So different amounts of fertilizer have been applied over several years to see if climate change and there's an increase in deposition, what is going to happen. So we can see the change in the plant community moving from more from mosses towards a larger number of vascular plants. So when we think of remote sensing, the first type of data that comes to mind is usually satellite imagery. And what we have here is a 1984 satellite image of Mer Bleu. And as we look at a few more recent ones, you can start to see how urban growth around Mer Bleu is getting closer and closer to the area. Now, satellite images are special. They're not quite the same as a photographic camera because all of these sensors are going to record light in wavelengths beyond what we can actually see with our eyes. So we can actually very specifically determine what kind of vegetation is present. Is it soil? Is it agriculture? Is it water? So we can ask really detailed questions about the landscape and how it changes over time. So here is 1999, 2016, and 2017. And not only do we get to ask questions about the different land cover types, but also how seasonality plays an effect and how the different kinds of land covers may change. Now, we're also very fortunate here to have more historical data sets. This is an air photo mosaic from 1965. And we'll look at some areas in comparison to one from 2011 to see in really high spatial detail how the landscape may have changed. So this is the area that you saw earlier that is currently the research boardwalk. But you can see in 1965 there was agriculture land in the south, and there really wasn't any development in the peatland itself. If we compare that to the same area in 2011, we can see that the agriculture land is no longer there, and we can see that the peatland area, that's where the access is for doing the different kinds of experimental studies. This is the center of Mer Bleu, and you can see those round black circles. Those are the scars left from ordinances. And if we take a look in 2011, some of those scars are still there. They still haven't fully recovered, and we can see a change in the vegetation. In the very north part of the peatland, you can see the peatland in the bottom part of the slide, and there's a lot of agriculture in the northern part, but that is now becoming sort of more intensively developed in 2011. And lastly, this is the area that you would know as the public boardwalk, where you may have gone to Mer Bleu, but in 1965 that didn't yet exist. This is what you'd be more familiar with if you were to go there today. So why do we want to look at peatlands, and why do we want to understand them from this remote perspective? And what do they actually contribute in terms of how they're going to adapt to either land cover or climate change? And so Mer Bleu gives us the opportunity to really understand the peatland's role in what is going to happen over climate change. It's the area that has the longest continuous record for northern peatland of measurement carbon exchange. And what we know is that over that entire period, it is actually a sink. It's actually taking up more carbon from the atmosphere. So it's helping to regulate in terms of climate change. But what is going to happen over time if there are increased stressors on it? So that's what we want to find out. And remote measurements and other kinds of data will help us get a small view into what may happen. These are the kinds of instruments that are there. So the primary measurements are coming from an eddy covariance tower that is going to record the concentration of carbon dioxide and methane in the atmosphere. And then those chambers that you see, they are sort of automatic. They open and close over time, and they measure at different types of vegetation what are the gases present and how are the gases exchanging with the vegetation. And there's also measurements of how much carbon is actually in the aquatic portion, what is leaving the system. And so this is an example from a colleague, Ellen Humphreys from Carleton University. So she's compiled the data from the eddy covariance tower for the last 16 years. And what we see is that even though there's a lot of variability, so there's a lot of space between those lines, but the pattern is very similar. And for all of these years, Mer Bleu has been actually taking up more carbon, so it is a sink. But you see that there are some years there highlighted in yellow where it's a very strong sink. And another example, they're highlighted in red, that it's not so strong. So what are the drivers that cause that kind of variability? And this is where some more unconventional tools, such as the remote sensing, could potentially shed light and help us understand those patterns. The backdrop that you see is Mer Bleu, but that was an image collected from an aircraft. And that aircraft belongs to the National Research Council, and it has a very special camera on board that allows us to image light in over 200 layers. So we can get a very detailed look at how the vegetation in each of those pixels is reflecting the sunlight. So we can ask what species are present in each pixel, and these are really small pixels. They're only a meter by 1 meter. So we can have a very detailed assessment of what is actually happening over time. And this particular mosaic here was collected because we were trying to understand with NRCan and with NRC how actually new satellites that are being launched, how good are they at actually observing peatlands? So if we don't have access to an aircraft, can we use these new satellites and really see what is happening in peatlands around the world using Mer Bleu as the actual study site? Now, the reason why you see a lot of red in this image is that those are the areas where you would have vascular plants with healthy green leaves. And we chose to display a near-infrared layer. So we can't see near-infrared, but the camera can record it very well. And plants that are healthy, that are green, are very reflective in that wavelength range. So when we display that on the screen, we see these areas that are going to be red and not really what we're used to seeing with our eyes if we look out of the aircraft. But having 200 layers to play with, we can really start to pick and choose and understand the ecosystem as much as possible. So what remote sensing allows us to do is we have the field level, which is, you can think of it like a microscope and very detailed observations. We go in the field, we collect samples, we take very fine measurements. We have the drones, the UAVs, that give us sort of centimeter scale information. Then we have the aircraft that collects this incredible wealth of data cube that shows us how the ecosystem can change over time. And we're working towards scaling that to satellite, because satellite gives us a very large scale view. So we can look at continental scale if we wish, or at some point sort of global scale, but we really need to start at that fine detail to really understand what we are seeing in the data. Now, what kinds of questions can we ask of this wealth of information? Well, we can map where the cotton grass is, and we care about cotton grass because it's going to be one of the plants that is going to be allowing methane to be released into the atmosphere. So we want to know how much cotton grass there is and where it is. And so on the bottom left there, you see an actual map of methane flux to the atmosphere based on where we found the cotton grass. And so 8% of the actual loss of carbon is from this methane. We can also map chlorophyll. So how much chlorophyll is actually in the plants, or how much nitrogen is in the plants? Similarly, we can map what is the water content. This gives us a view of the actual health of the ecosystem. Is there something that is happening that's maybe stressing the vegetation? We can look at those questions because we have these really detailed data, both in spatially, because we have 1 meter by 1 meter pixels, but also because we have all of those layers of information. From the UAV, we can also reconstruct the surface in 3 dimensions. So this is where we get that centimeter scale data from. So the larger piece there is a 2 centimeter spatial detail reconstruction of an area of Mer Bleu. And the one on the right, we did really fine detail, so 0.5 centimeter. So here we have a digital record of the actual 3-dimensional structure of the plants. So we can start to see how they grow, how they change, what is their volume, what is their biomass. And it's really the last few years, as the UAV technology has improved, that's really allowed us to do this kind of modeling. And when I've been asked, well, how accurate is this? And we can say that for the kind of peatland that we're looking at Mer Bleu, we can actually be less than 1 centimeter off in terms of the actual spatial location, and much finer when we're trying to measure, for example, the volume or the size of different objects. So here's another view of that 3-dimensional representation. So we can see a cross-section of what does the vegetation look like? How tall are those hummocks with the vascular plants? Or where are those hollows with the actual mosses? And one of the most exciting things this summer is that that camera that I showed you the image from with the red for the vascular plants has been miniaturized. And in collaboration with NRC, we were able to put it on a larger UAV. And we have those same 200 layers there, but now at 5 centimeter pixels. So we can look at smaller than a plant and really see what is actually happening to that ecosystem. So this is a very new, very exciting opportunity that we've been able to pursue because the technology is advancing so rapidly. And if you're interested to look at more images and more data sets, I urge you to take a look at that link. And it gives you sort of a historical overview of the images that I showed, as well as examples of the data sets as well. Thank you.
You mentioned earlier on that you could also look at water level. Have you had any observations about water level in the bog and the temporal trends?
This year was very interesting, as we had very high water level, and where you saw the actual boardwalks, early in the season they were actually underwater. There were parts of it that when you walked, you were essentially walking on water. And there were some years going back, like 2012, for example, that was extremely dry. So the water table level was 0.5 meter or more actually below the surface. So it does change very much year to year and month to month as well.
No long-term trends?
There are a few years that really stick out, but it's more the seasonal trend that is consistent over time.
So you said you wanted to compare the data you're getting to, like 1 meter pixels and fine detail with satellites that are coming online. What sort of pixel size are you looking at with those?
So the example that we were looking at this summer was for a satellite called Sentinel-2, and we were looking specifically at the 10-meter pixels. And the reason that's also interesting is we're hoping to have this long-term monitoring program at Mer Bleu, both from the aircraft level as well as with these new satellites, so we can look at how the data changes if we go from 10 meters for Sentinel-2 to 30 meters for Landsat, or other resolutions from other sensors that may come.
So you'd be kind of calibrating, you look at your detail and see how that maps to the larger pixel and
exactly.
Then can extrapolate from that.
Exactly. So the larger pixels are going to give us there's less detail, but it gives us the same trends actually. And what we found is with the seasonal patterns that we can see from the aircraft or from the point sampling we do on the ground actually translates really well to the satellite imagery. So even though we're looking at landscape level and coarser pixels, the trends we see in greening or the trends that we see in phenology are actually consistent. So the data coming from these new satellites is really good.
Hi, do you have or have you developed a nutrient budget and water budget for Mariboa as a whole, for the bog as a whole?
Not myself, my colleagues are actively working on that. So two of our colleagues, one is very much focused on the hydrology mm-hmm. and trying to understand the monthly and the yearly water budgets. And there's another group that is actively trying to understand the carbon balance, as well as other nutrients from nitrogen to phosphorus and those as well.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, yeah, I was just wondering about the, was there bombing in that, in Mariboa during the Second World War? Like, was it bombing range?
Those were the bomb craters mm-hmm. in the air photo from 1965, yes.
Okay, and I'm just wondering, is there still ordnance in there that that could be undetonated? Or?
I believe would be the best to answer.
Yeah, I was just kind of wondering if they'd cook off every once in a while, you get the odd detonation. But
no. I believe, as you mentioned, it was sort of lower on the.
Okay, thank you.
I was just wondering to what extent, if at all, you used Agriculture Canada, because when I was with the NCC in 62 and we were defining the Green Belt, Agriculture Canada were providing all of the research support for the Mariboa and all of the other aspects. Do you use these other government agencies in this sort of thing?
My colleagues at NRC collaborate very closely with Agriculture Canada. And so they do have a very strong ongoing collaboration, okay. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, that was great. I wanted to ask if they're using similar technology to track carbon emissions in agriculture as well. If the data is so precise, is it feasible or is it too expensive to do that kind of thing? Especially in the Green Belt, given NCC owns a lot of agricultural land around Ottawa?
So one of the areas that had the greatest sort of surge in research and helped us develop these tools is actually remote sensing for agricultural purposes. So in terms of understanding what we see in data that represents different crop types, absolutely. And that's why what the tools that we're using for Mariboa as a peatland are certainly transferable to other types of land covers, and agriculture is one that has had, I guess, the largest investment of time and effort to really be able to use these tools for that purpose.
So, as you mentioned early on in your talk, that this data set from Mariboa is one of the longest running continuous data sets for a bog. I wondered, in terms of carbon sink and carbon release, or methane release, what are some of the things you're finding in that, in with respect to Mariboa and the contribution of that knowledge in terms of some of our understanding of how peatlands are moderating or changing in terms of climate change?
And what one of the main messages is that as the area becomes drier, then Mariboa or peatlands in general are going to become less of a sink. So we are very concerned in terms of them being able to retain the moisture and having that moisture balance, because if they become too dry, that's when they start to move towards becoming less of a sink and perhaps someday may become a source.
I imagine the soil of peat bog is acidic, so I guess the acid rain had no effect on it?
It helps to slow the decomposition of the organic material. So that's what we do have at Mariboa, between 5 to 6 meters deep in the center section in terms of how deep that peat is. And so one of the factors that contributes to the slower decomposition is, as you mentioned, it is actually quite acidic.
So I just want to thank again our three great speakers, Dr. Kalashka, Dr. McCory, and Dr. Surjet, and Monsieur Surjet Garba. I think everyone found that really interesting. I certainly did, learning more about Mirebog, or more Bleu Bog, and the biodiversity that we have. Les connaissances scientifiques solides fournies par ces chercheurs-là sont vraiment des outils importants pour nous. Il faut vous rassurer vraiment qu'on trouve ça plus qu'intéressant, mais vraiment nécessaire pour la bonne gestion puis la planification de nos terrains, également dans le parc Le Gatineau, qu'au Mer Bleu et les terrains urbains. And it helps us even with our planning mandate, so we're really grateful for that. We had a number of scientific researchers who were here today beyond our speakers. I'd like to thank them again, if some of them might still be here, and thank you all for coming out. Donc, j'espère que vous avez eu du plaisir. Je pense que nos conférenciers vont rester sur place pour un couple de minutes si vous restez questions. And thank you for coming out. Have a safe trip home. Merci. Oh, and we're going to thank them with our presence. I'm sorry about that.
So thank you very much. Merci à tout le monde. Just a reminder, our next Urbanism Lab will be December 4th in conjunction with Carleton University Urban Forum Series. So it will be at the National Gallery, not here in our space. And the subject is Imaging the City. We will have speakers from Carleton University, from the Sensible Cities Lab at MIT, and Fadi Massoud from the University of Toronto. So we hope to see you there. Donc, je vous invite à participer à notre prochain événement du labo le 4 décembre. Mais ça va pas, c'est pas ici dans notre salle, c'est à la Galerie nationale, au Musée des Beaux-Arts. Donc, le 4 décembre, le sujet, c'est l'imagerie numérique de la ville avec trois invités. Un du Sensible Cities Lab à l'université MIT aux États-Unis, Stephen Fay de l'université Carleton et Fadi Massoud de l'université de Toronto. Donc, à la prochaine. Merci. Thank you.